Blackstone Audio presents The Big Both Ways by John Straley. This book is read by Barry Press. 1. Even though she had never traded sex for money, she was nothing now but a whore with a bloody nose. It was a hard fact to accept, but there it was. She looked at the man curled in the trunk of the car, blood oiling over his white shirt. She had his broken watch in her hand, its intricate guts at a standstill, the second hand trembling between two painted tick marks on the face. It was only then that she started to cry. Her sobs leaked between her bloody fingers as she tried to stifle the sound. A mile to the west, a car hissed over the pavement, and somewhere in the woods, a screen door slammed. She stepped toward him then. Tears flecked off her chin as she lifted the cold arm to place the watch back around his wrist. She was thinking that he might as well keep it, for however stupid it seemed, even in a world gone mad, a broken watch could still be right twice a day. It was May 1935. In April, Amelia Earhart had set a speed record on a solo flight from Los Angeles to Mexico City. And when she took off again, she set another from Mexico City to New York. In the American Southwest, a blizzard of dust scoured the tired farmland, and the Roosevelt administration began relocating dust bowlers to communal farms in the territory of Alaska. In August, Will Rogers and Wiley Post were to set off in their Lockheed Orion for Point Barrow, and on June 24th, the miners of the Alaska Juneau gold mine would riot when scabs started marching up the street to the hiring hall. All of these things would take on a new meaning to Slippery Wilson in the months to come, but just then, he was looking halfway up a big-budded Douglas fir tree, listening to his bull buck tell him something through a wad of chew. His given name was Jack, but his parents had called him Slippery. Like many people during the Depression, he wanted to be hopeful. Others had told him that life was hard, but he had not seen it that way. He had always been stubborn in his optimism, but now he was beginning to wonder.
"Well, I guess you better scamper up there and cut him down," the bull buck said as he spit out a stream of tobacco juice into the duff.
They were standing in the northern woods of the Skagit River drainage in Washington State. The wind was sour with the smell of pitch. 70 feet up in a broken tree, Judd White was slumped dead from his climbing rope, where a partially rotted limb from the fir he was topping had hit him square in the chest. High up in the tree, Judd's torso was at a sickening angle to his waist, his axe swinging from its lanyard attached to his belt.
"You better get up there and cut him down," the bull buck repeated.
It was just after sunrise, and the tired men around him had stopped rattling through the brush. Gray jays flitted in the slash of tangled branches. The hook tenders who had already oiled up their bones with the first hard half hour of clambering down the cut stood watching him, their faces toward the sun like flowers in their round, hard hats.
"No, I'm sorry," he said to the bull buck, who was standing flat-footed amongst a tangle of rigging cable. "I'm going to draw my pay."
And he started walking out of the woods. It had been 3 years since Slip had left the failing ranch in eastern Washington. Roosevelt had promised reclamation and electrification. The high desert country east of the Cascades would be a new Eden. Slip had watched the men hitchhiking with cardboard suitcases to the dam sites. He had picked apples, put up hay, and milked his family's cows for his entire life. But when his father died and the bank took it all, he decided to follow those men up the river. As if to show them the rightness of his choice, the old cow kicked him one last time while he loaded her into the buyer's truck, and even then he thought only of the thick, sweet milk she had given.
He sold his logging boots for $5. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.